Testing. Ooh, you're right. Sensitive. Whitney, can we or do we shut those back doors? We don't. Okay. All right. Well, welcome to Bible study. My name is Katie Anderson. I'm one of the teachers here, just filling in for announcements today. So the first thing I'll tell you is if you could please silence your cell phones. Okay. Here are the announcements. Nursery is now available on Wednesday mornings, and so kids 4 and under are welcome. A lot of those young mamas who have little kids have quit coming to Bible study, so if you will encourage them, come on back, because we have nursery. We are not serving snacks, so you guys will need to bring clearly labeled sippy cups or a bottle. And nursery is also available for church beginning this Sunday for kids who are 2 and under. So pass it along, text your friends, Facebook message or whatever. Also, I don't know if y'all have seen this flyer. It's outside. It's our Women to Women flyer. We have all kinds of fun groups that you can join. And they include things like this one at the top that I saw this morning. I was like, what is this? It's called Fellowship Over Food. And actually, the group eats a lot, which I think sounds fun, but also they're going through a cookbook together, which I think sounds super fun. And all the contact information and everything is on this sheet. There's also a Mrs. to Mrs., which is like a marriage support group, and you don't have to be a member of the church to go to any of these, so, you know, grab a friend and come to one. There is one called Keeping Company with Christ, Friend to Friend. There is a great book club I've gone to a few times. And then one called Breakfast Over Your Bible, where people, you know, you learn to really be in the scripture a lot. And finally, there's this one called LOL, which is meeting for the first time this month. And it is for empty nesters, and it is going to meet for lunch after Bible study, so on Wednesday, the 21st. So, oh yeah, that's a Wednesday. I was like, that doesn't fit in the weekend. So that's in a couple weeks. But you need, if you want to attend this, you bring your own lunch and drinks and dessert will be provided. So that too would be a fun time to grab an empty nester friend and bring in her Bible study, and then y'all stay for lunch. Let's see. Okay, I think those are all the announcements. So today we have a new teacher, Pamela Grafton, who is right here. She'll be up in a minute. She is a wife, a mother, a friend, a daughter. Her mother is in attendance today. And she's a tennis lover. She's an accountant, maybe. Would you say that? Yeah, that was your degree. And she works with puppies in a new job, which I find to be just fascinating. And she is a fantastic Bible study teacher. So here is Pamela.
We pray.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Father, I just thank you so much for just this room of women who want to learn your word, Lord. I thank you for this beautiful weather, for Pamela's willingness to teach us. I pray that you would just make our hearts fertile ground for what we're going to learn today about fear, Lord. I pray that for those of us who are struggling with fear, that Pamela's words and the words in your word would just give us such comfort, especially as we are living through COVID, as we're sitting here with masks on, Lord. And I just ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Get your mask. Okay, y'all hear me? Good morning. I'm excited to be here to teach. I love it. It's one of my most favorite things. Anna and I were talking about, she was kind of warning me that it is indeed odd to teach to a room full of masks, all spread out. It feels very sterile. And we were saying, like, I need reaction. So our new suggestion, you know, we're Presbyterian, we don't yell amen a lot, but like if you're jiving, like maybe nod, or Anna's suggestion, like you can do some jazz hands or thumbs up if it's funny or something. So just nod. It's odd. It'll take me a minute to get used to it, but I'm excited you're here, masks and all, and my mom. So this week we're talking about how to sing through fear. I think this is an emotion definitely in a year like this we are all pretty familiar with. And it has probably struck us more than we are used to. In the homework notebook, whether you read it or not, is fine. The first thing I started with was just to have you ponder, you know, if someone says, what do you fear? What are some things you think about? From the little bitty things to the big things, you know, to the child that's terrified of bees and they run across, or the things that keep you up at night. You know, I wanted you to just chew on what are those things that you fear, because often there are things that we fear, but until they're right in front of us, sometimes we don't realize how deep that fear goes. I had one of these experiences this summer. I was at the lake with my girls, my two teenagers. They had a couple of friends. We'd been down at the dock, but it started pouring down rain, so we were running up to the house. It's about 30 wooden steps to get up to the house. So we're running. The friends get up. You know, the bottom has just dropped out. It's pouring. The friends get up to the patio. I'm in the middle. The girls are maybe 10 steps behind me, and I hear these screams for terror. Snake! And if you ask me, what are you afraid of? Snake's going to be number one. Hate them. Can't do it. So here we are, pouring down rain. You know, I'm halfway up to almost security, and my girls are down there screaming. There's a snake that was poking its head in between two of the wooden steps, some of their slats. And it was poking its head out, you know, in between a step so they couldn't step up. So you think, what are you going to do? Like, your children are down here trapped. There's this snake, and it was not a tiny snake, poking its head out. They're screaming, like, it's going to kill us. Even Addie, my calm one, was like, I mean, it's looking at us like it's about to attack, and they would not step over it. What do I do as a mother? Y'all, I froze. I did nothing except for stand on my step that was 10 feet closer to security and sort of yell direction at them. I'm mortified when I think back at how little I did to help my children. You would think I would run down there, I would get a stick, I would shoo the snake away. I stood up there and just was like, run around it, or you know, jump the rail and run up in the yard. They wouldn't do it. They were convinced it was going to chase them. You'd have thought this was like a python ready to kill them. It was, in the end, like this big, harmless snake. But I really haven't quite gotten over how I failed my children, because I just, I like to tell them, I'm like, I didn't go in. I stayed in the rain with you until I called the neighbor to come kill it for us. I did not leave you in your distress, but I really did not help them. So it was one of those situations where I realized I really am afraid of a snake, and it paralyzed me, and I did not offer to help my children. I did not throw myself in front of the snake to let Chase run to safety. So I'm just owning that. So, you know, sometimes things happen, and we realize how deep our fears are. And I think that is what a lot of us have felt like in 2020. And when everything shut down this spring, we talked about it in small group. I know for me too, I felt fears that I was not used to feeling. And I think we've all had to deal with things that kind of shook our world in a way we're not used to. Because I think it just, all of this got turned upside down really quickly. You know, and it challenged our health, it challenged the health of our loved ones, it challenged our jobs, it challenged our routines, it challenged our securities, it challenged, you know, what we do with our children that keeps them happy. Just a lot of things that we maybe knew we would be afraid of or not be comfortable in that situation, but all of a sudden they were right in front of us. And I think that's where we probably today can come to this lesson semi on the same page, because I think we've probably dealt with a lot of the same feelings this year, and just the uncertainty and the unrest just stirs up a lot of fear in us. And as we're learning over and over this semester, you'll hear us probably keep repeating each other, the key to all these emotions that we're going to go through, we really can't avoid them always. I don't think this side of heaven we will ever get to a perfect place where we don't feel some of these things. But the key is how we handle them. And where we take them, as opposed to letting them define us or define our situation or control us or paralyze us like I was this summer. It's just teaching us, and we're learning from these Psalms how to take them to God over and over and over. And just the answer is to take them to God in prayer. So let's read Psalm 3. This first Psalm that we have of David, really in the same situation that Anna talked about last week, where he is fleeing for his life from his son Absalom and thousands of soldiers that are trying to kill him. And I love that one of my books even mentioned that, I mean, God starts right off with this one, Psalm 3. You know, he's kind of positioned us with the Psalms and what our view of the kingdom should be. And then he says, here we go. You know, here I'm going to show you an example of how to walk through fear, because I know it's going to happen over and over and over. So let me just read through this, and then we'll kind of work through it. Oh, Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and I slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessings be on your people. So first, really, Whitney, you can switch to it. Here's what we're going to walk through, just so you know where we are. But just at the most basic level, you know, what is fear? And it sounds so silly and trite, but I just want to say it. Fear's real. We know that, but I just want to validate you that, I mean, it is a real emotion that I think we're all very familiar with, and we experience it at times. One of the talks I listened to talked about that it's probably the first emotion we fear. As a newborn baby, when you come out of that safe, happy, warm, dark setting, and you're pulled out into reality and you're screaming, that's probably fear of that baby saying, what in the world? And where's my safe place? So it's just innate in us. And fear, you'll see, and I think 2 or 3 weeks, Eden is teaching on anxiety. And we discussed whether or not that was too repetitive, but where we landed and with studying that they're really two different things. So, and if they are sort of similar in your mind, that is great news, because you're going to get two lessons on it then. But they really are different. Fear, one person we listened to talked about that fear is more of that thunderstorm. You know, there's a tangible thing that you can see or feel that is causing you danger. Anxiety is more of that months of rainy days in Seattle. It's just that feeling, and you can't necessarily put your finger on it, but it's just causing you unrest. But there's a distinction in the two. Fear is also unique, and I've really chewed on this a good bit too, in that we all fear. I think it's common to all of us, but we do it in different ways. You know, you see, well, I clearly was paralyzed by the snake. My neighbor, on the other hand, that came to rescue us with his shovel, was not. He went right down there and enjoyed saving, you know, my children in distress. You know, we fear different things, and that's natural. But I think as Christians, we should be sensitive to that and be aware of that. And I think God designed us that way, so that when someone is in a fearful situation, we can come alongside them and support them and quote truth to them, and then they can do the same for us. Fear is also, though, it is sometimes protection. Fear is not always a bad thing. If you're in the ocean and see a shark, and that causes you to fear and then swim away, that's protection. That's not a bad thing. Fear can sometimes give you safety. If fear makes you maybe slow down going around that curve, that's protection. I think God uses fear in our life, too. Sometimes he uses it to show us things or show us false idols in our life. That's protection. So fear is not always a bad thing. And lastly, too, fear is really insight into our souls and into what's going on in our lives and how we have things structured. Those things we fear the most are often sort of spotlights onto where we've put someone or something on the throne in our lives where God should really be. It's a hard exercise to go through sometimes, but it's healthy, and it helps show us where we maybe have these idols in our life. I heard one time that it's often the thing that keeps you, if you want to do an idol check in your heart, look at and consider what keeps you up at night. You know, I would like to say that it's, you know, we stay up at night stewing over how to be more righteous, you know, or how to be more Christ-like. But usually it's not. Usually it's other things. It's our children. It's our jobs. It's our health. It's our comfort. It's security. And sometimes those things have become too important in our lives, or they come in front of God. So fear sometimes can show you those idols. With fear, it's always so important. Like I said in that homework question, I think we can say, you know, if someone asks, what are you afraid of? But it's always important with fear to dig down to the root of that, to not just stop at, okay, snakes is not a good example, but because it's silly, but you dig down in your fears and say, okay, if I'm fearing this, why? What's at the root of that? Kind of run that scenario out to see what's really causing the fear, and that's sometimes where you need to meet God to do an idol check. You know, Les gave me some great examples that you sort of walk through of like, if our greatest fear is losing our job, then maybe we've placed too much security in finances or worldly comforts. You know, do we fear, like this spring, missing events or activities or changing our routine? It's often because that's where we've decided we're going to find all our joy, and that's misplaced. You know, do we have this fear of our kids failing or embarrassing us? It's because maybe we've put too much focus on that control or our reputation or our identity and their success. You know, do we stay up at night? Are we in fear of this election? I don't care which side you're on. It is a mess, and it can cause fear and confusion and turmoil. We all just want peace, I know. But if it's causing you too much fear, then maybe that's a sign that you've lost your focus on, oh, yeah, these are just earthly men. And our focus is really on a heavenly king that is really in control. So you use your fears to kind of dig to the root to see maybe what's underneath. David shows this in Psalm 2. Go back to that for a minute. The first thing he does, and this is where we always start when we feel this coming up in us, is to stop and say, what am I fearing and why? And that's what David does in this first couple of verses. He brings that straight to God. He says first in verse 1, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. We see later there are thousands. Somebody listened to said probably 12,000 soldiers, and he's alone hiding in the wilderness. That would cause fear. He is accurate that his life is probably in danger. That's a real physical fear. But then also in verse 2, what he's saying, he said, many are saying of my soul that there's no salvation for him in God. So he's fearful for his identity and his purpose. He knows that these people are also attacking his reputation as God's chosen king, who once was just in the beloved spot of God's chosen, but he made poor mistakes, as we talked about last week with Anna, and he's ruined everything, and he's made terrible, sinful mistakes, and he's now on the run for his life, and he's saying, these people have no value, say I have no value in you. So he has both, which we can relate to that, he has both a physical fear, but also, you know, they're getting into his identity and his security, which we can relate to also. But then in verse 3, he turns, and like I talked about, one author talked about it as misplaced glories. I loved that phrase when we talk about idols. We have that fear because we've put something in place of God, where God should be first, that misplaced glory. And David sees that right there in verse 3. He says, but you, O Lord, I'm skipping the shield till later, but says, are my glory. He says, I understand. He said, that's all. You need to be my only glory. So next, where should we take our fears? What should we do? And the bottom line is we should let our fears take us to Christ and not from him. We don't let them paralyze you or define you or destroy you or thwart your walk with God. They should drive us to Christ. You know, we know this from our youngest age. We either can remember doing it or we have children that have done it many a time. In the middle of the night, if they have a nightmare or hear something or see something, what do? They call out to their parents, right? How many times have we woken up, you know, when they're younger and you turn over and you wake up and there's a child right there at your face, you know, because they had a nightmare or something. Weirdly, I had this happen to me this spring. I think it was, you know, when we were all home for so much and our schedules were all out of whack. And literally, it was like 1 a.m. and Addie and Chase were at my bedside, but they're not here, they're here, saying they'd heard something upstairs and they were terrified. There was surely someone in the attic. So, I mean, at a young age or whatever, we know, like, I got to go to somebody with this. I need to go to my parents with this. I need to go to my loving father with these. And that's what God tells us to do, is bring these fears to me. That is really the only solution. It's the only way that we can get out of that paralyzed state of fear and turn it into hope. He says right here in verse 4, I cried aloud to the Lord. And that's what these psalms are. They're sort of practice for us in learning how to, okay, here's this emotion. Let me see what the word says about how to practice this and how to take it to the Lord. They're examples for us on how to walk through these. So he says, I cried aloud to the Lord and he answered me. Psalm 34:4 also says, I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. It's a change of our perspective. It's a shifting from the focusing on the thing that we fear to the only one who can defeat it. And it's just going to God and focusing on him. That's where we can find hope. It was interesting, and this is sort of a teaser for next week when I'm teaching on hope, but Anna and I had both been studying, looking for the right chapters to cover these emotions, and I had chosen some, and then she had some different books and came over and brought me some articles. And it was interesting twice, truly. I can't make this up. I could have, but I didn't. One of the verses I had chosen on fear that actually I had taped on my pantry this spring when I was in such a fearful state was one that she brought me on hope. And one that I had already circled for hope was one that she brought me as one in fear. And it was such a beautiful reminder to me from God. I mean, so tangible. Literally, I had these articles sitting side by side on my table of that. I mean, they really can be just two sides of the same coin. It's just a matter of flipping our perspective. God says, I don't want you to stay in fear. I want you to find the hope that I'm promising you. And it's just a matter of coming to me, focusing on me, so I can flip that perspective. The key is just to pray through our fears in the presence of God. I probably will keep repeating this, and I can feel I keep saying the same thing, but it is, there's not really an answer to this fear other than bring it to God and pray through it. And he tells us that he will help shift us to hope. One author said, describe David here. It said, the God-centeredness of his gaze kept his life steady. And I love that because even when he is, I mean, hopefully not many of us have been in quite a fearful situation as this of hiding in the wilderness from thousands that are trying to kill you. But he had such a God-centeredness of his gaze that he could remain steady. Even in when I think of fear too, my mind went to Daniel in the lion's den. When he heard about this decree that you weren't to worship God, and if you were, you were going to be thrown in the lion's den, I would be fearful. I would be running away. But it says the first thing he did, it's in Daniel 6. You can look up that story later, but it says, when he learned of this decree, he went home as he always did and opened the window and prayed. And I love that. When he was in that most fearful situation, he prayed. And he knew that the best place to be in that fear was right beside God. Psalm 23 is very familiar to many of us. I'm not going to read the whole thing. But this, and I think it is so familiar, and so we probably sometimes glaze over this. But he says in verse 4, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. None. I will fear no evil in the valley of the shadow of death. But why is that? It says, because you are with me. That's the key. That's our hope. For your rod and your staff, they comfort me. So we need to go to him with our fears and walk with him. And then next, what does he say and what does he do? Lamentations 3:57 is the most clear. It just says, you came near when I called on you. You said, do not fear. Isaiah 41:10-13 says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, fear not. I am the one who helps you. John 14:27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Not as the world gives you do I give. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. I told them this morning that I was going to just read a lot of scripture in here because I think it's, I would never try to say it better than this. God says it over and over in scripture, just do not fear. And he doesn't say it in a rebuking way, but he says it as a loving father who knows the end and he knows the protection that he can give us. It is one of the most common commands in the Bible, a fear not, a do not fear. And I think that's because he knows it's something that we're going to struggle with. And lovingly, he just keeps reminding us. He keeps meeting us there, walking beside us, comforting us when we need it, and telling us, you don't have to fear. And I was struck, too, with, as I kind of chewed on this, like sometimes that's surreal to think, how does he say do not fear? You know, but it's not do not fear unless. It's not do not fear, but I understand if it's 2020. It's not do not fear until this happens. It's just do not fear. We were driving this summer out of town and got stuck in probably one of the worst storms I've ever gotten stuck in a car. And we were out of town, so I didn't hear, I know when the tornado's near my house, but we were somewhere we weren't familiar, and so we couldn't even check on the radar. There were tornado warnings going off. You couldn't see. I mean, it was so bad that we pulled over some exit. We were in the middle of nowhere in Alabama, and I mean, it was truly, there was nowhere to find shelter short of knocking on someone's door. Like, we found the church. It was locked up. We finally pulled over and went in a Dollar General. But, I mean, it was the Dollar General that you see on the news, you know, that's then been blown away by the tornado. And it was one of those, I mean, truly, like, just very fear-inducing. I mean, there was just no other way to put it. We couldn't decide if we should drive or stop. And if we were driving, I was truly looking, like, where's that ditch? Because they say get out of your car, get in the ditch if the tornado comes. And it was as I was working on this, and I just, it sounds so basic, but I think it's a healthy exercise for all of us. I just really pondered, like, even in this, God is saying, do not fear. And all I could do was say, God, like, I really don't understand that. You know, I don't. I am not capable of that. I don't know how to do that in this situation where I'm truly looking for shelter for my family. But I think there's some peace in that and some comfort of, like, he knows that, he sees that, and he says, do not fear. You don't have to fear, even in this. Of course, we think of when the disciples were on the boat with him in the storm, where they were fearing for their lives. And he's sleeping because he knows his power and his control. And he tells them, why are you afraid? He just tells us over and over. And again, this is not ever going to be an instantaneous thing, like we're going to walk out of here and together, okay, the 50 of us, we are not ever going to fear again. I wish that could happen, but I don't think it's going to. And all we can do is just keep taking those fears to him and just reminding ourselves of his truth that he says, you don't have to fear. But what also does he do for us? I love this in verses 3 and 4. David then says, but you, O Lord, are my shield. Verse 5, he sustains me. He even gives us sleep. I mean, this is in the middle of his fear. This is in the middle of the people are still chasing them. But somehow he finds rest and peace in the midst of it. That's what only God can do. One person I listened to, I love this analogy or the image of the shield. I think sometimes we read that and we glaze over it and, okay, yeah, God's our shield. But I thought this was so beautiful. He described, like, if you're leaving your house in the morning and you know it's going to be a great, beautiful day, let's say like today, and you're coming to Bible study, I don't see any of you with shields. You know, if you know it's going to be a perfect day and things are going to go your way, a shield is not in the equation. A shield, you take it up when you know there are going to be hard times. You know there are going to be enemies. You know you're going to be in a situation where you need protection. And I love that because what it's saying is that God does not promise that we will walk through life without fear. God does not promise that we will have, you know, enemy-free lives or not face battles or hard things or things that we should fear. Some people will tell you that. And this person that was preaching on this said, you know, if you're looking for that God that promises all things, you know, it's going to be great and rosy and you will not face trials and enemies, that God is not in this Bible. God says there will be hard times. But like in Psalm 23, he says, I will be right beside you. I will comfort you. And that's how you can face them without fear. He's going to be that shield to protect the most vital parts of us. and as close to us as he can be in that battle. And that's what David sees, that God is right here and he is protecting me. He's not taking away this situation yet. Sometimes he does, but he says, right now while I'm in this, you're my shield. You're right here with me. Deuteronomy 3:22 says, you shall not fear them, for it is the Lord your God who fights for you. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Psalm 46:1-3, love this. This, you might want to star this one definitely in this year. It says, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way. And does it not feel like this year that the earth is giving way and our structure and our society and everything we've trusted is giving way? It says, therefore, we will not fear. Going back to that story of children running to their parents' bed at night, I think the best example of what God does with us, he doesn't just say, don't fear. Like in those verses, he's with us and he wants to be with us. In case you didn't catch it, or you were dozing, when I mentioned that my two daughters came to our bed this spring, or if you don't know me, my daughters are 17 and 13, okay? Chase is certainly old enough to know that there's not a man living in her attic, okay? I think we had left a light on in the attic off her room. She'd convinced herself at 1 a.m. there was a man living in the attic, even though we'd been in full quarantine for weeks, and Addie was still awake, so she then convinced her 17-year-old sister that there was a man living in the attic, and they had to come get us. So it was ridiculous. I mean, but the dearest part of this story, and I give him the credit because I think I fell quickly back asleep, they told me that, but Alan, at 1 a.m, he doesn't just shoo them away, as he easily could have with teenagers. This is not a 3-year-old that you need to tuck back in bed. These are teenagers. He didn't just shoo them away and say, oh, don't be afraid. That makes me mad. He got up out of bed in the middle of the night, got a gun, I think, walked them back upstairs, went in the attic, turned on the light. Like, he went with them, and he walked beside them, and he showed them, there's nothing to fear because I'm here and I can protect you. God does not just shoo us away. He's our shield and he's our protector and he's with us. And I just thought that was a beautiful example of how our loving Father does that for us. When we go to him with our fears, he knows that we're okay. Like he told the disciples in the boat, why are you afraid? He knows, but he walks with us anyway, day by day. We don't fear because of who we are or our strength or our determination or our resolve to not fear. We can find that do not fear only because who he is, only in his strength. He is a loving God. He is a sustaining God, a sufficient God, a restoring God, an accessible God who listens when we cry for him, and he answers, and he walks upstairs with us, and he gives his protection. So lastly, why? Why are we not to fear? I guess really I could have said how. How do we do this? He says don't fear. How? And the answer is pretty simple. It's because, like I just said, we know him and we know his character. But even beyond that, we know the ending. We know the ending of this book. Chase, my youngest, my fearful little Chase, she and I have this weird new love for these Lifetime movies that, you know, the kind of scary drama mysteries, and we watch them over and over. But it helps me, and like anything, and I think Anna even alluded to this, sometimes if we're facing something fearful, like, if we know the end is going to be okay, it's not so scary, right? And that is definitely true when you watch a scary Lifetime movie because, you know, number one, it's on Lifetime. So the good people are always going to win. And even when you watch these movies, or you know, even old horror movies you can relate to, I never liked them at slumber parties. I was the one in the back hiding, you know, the old scary ones. But, you know, you also could tell which characters were going to make it and not, right? And then these Lifetime movies, you know, the cute teenager, she's going to be fine. You know, if it's a scary Disney movie, you know, like, this one's going to be fine. Now the stalker nanny that, you know, kidnapped the baby, she might not be okay in this movie. And, you know, in the horror movie, you could tell, like, the good teenager, he's going to be okay, but kind of the bad girl that runs in the barn by herself. But these stories, it comforts me when I watch them because I know the ending. And I know the good guys are going to be okay. I know the main characters that nothing's going to happen to them. And that's with this. That is the way we can find this place of not fearing. It's because we know the ending. And we know our value in the story. Nothing can touch us. We talk about this Bible often here as it's one big story. It is one big story of God redeeming his people and trying and his moving towards his reunion with us in heaven. And so we know the ending. And here it is in Revelation 1:17. It's amazing. It says, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. I don't know why this verse gets me emotional. But it says, he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not. I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades. And that's the how. Because everything that we fear has already been defeated and accomplished. Everything. Romans 8:38 says, for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. It's like David when he said, you alone are my glory. When, and this is the key, when we place all of our hope and security in him alone, there is nothing to fear. That is the way that we can get to this why or how of not to fear. It is when we place all of our hope and security in him. And it's when we can see past this thing that is causing us the fear, and we look past that, and we flip that coin to hope, and we look at Jesus and what he's accomplished, and we look at what God is promising. That's how we can find peace from this fear. If our hope and security are in things like our finances, our children, our health, our relationships, our status, our reputation, our comfort, those will fail us. And so you will rightly have fear there. But when our hope is in Christ alone, we can truly find that peace. He calms the storms. He is the great healer. He controls the nations. He speaks to the winds and the waves, and they obey him. He defeated death on the cross. It is finished. And so our eternity is secure in what he has done and because of him. Isaiah 43:1 says, fear not, I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. And I want to read real quick to Isaiah 25, if you want to flip there and star these verses. I love them when we are fearful. Isaiah 25, 8 and 9. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord God. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Because we know the ending. I'll end with this quick story. I've already told you my snake story. I cannot pretend to model this for you perfectly of what it looks like to face something and not be fearful, but I saw it in a dear friend once. And why am I so weepy today? Because it's 2020, right? Can I get some jazz hands? Most of you know Susan Tyner, who was ever our women's minister here for years and taught us for years, and we all love her dearly. And her faith is amazing. And maybe, I think it was the year before they moved to Texas. I'm sure many of you know and remember they found a tumor in her stomach that was cancerous. And it was very uncertain. It was confusing and potentially very, very severe and possibly terminal and just uncertain. And she was headed to MD Anderson in Texas for the full analysis and to get start treatment. And I remember I was at her house the night before they left visiting with her, and I knew what I was experiencing and feeling because of how much I loved her, but I was struck by her calmness, I guess to say. And I may be paraphrasing a little bit, but basically I asked her, I said, what are you thinking? Like, what are you feeling? Are you scared of this? She looked at me with the most calm reaction and said, she was like, no, I'm not afraid. She said, truly, she said this to me. She said, I would rather not have this be terminal. I would rather not die of this cancer this year. But I trust God. And if that's the plan, I can't change it, first of all. And I trust him. So why would I be afraid? She was facing possibly terminal cancer and could look at me as calmly as that and say, I don't fear. And like David, and Susan would be the first to say, she is far from perfect. And I'm sure it took her maybe a minute to get to that place. But in that moment, she modeled that so perfectly to me. And I'll never forget it. And I think she just embodied what God is trying to teach us here. It's that there are times when even you are facing the hardest things and the biggest trials, that you can look at them and say, I don't fear, because I trust you and I see you. And Susan knew. She knew the end of this story. And she knew her role in God's story. And her role was way too important. She knew her life was secure. And she modeled that better than I can imagine. And that's what we're to do. You know, what if we could all focus our faith and hope in him alone so that we could be so bold? What if we always faced our fears by turning them to prayers? What if we faced everything in this crazy life and this crazy year and found rest and peace instead of fear? What if we could use our fears to check our idols and shift our focus only to God? And what if we could truly believe him when he said, do not fear? It seems impossible, and I know that, and it is without Christ and without having him as the center and our only glory. But with him, we can shift from fear to hope, with our gaze on him and our salvation that he has secured for us. I'll end with where David does in Psalm 3. He says, salvation belongs to you, Lord. Your blessings be on your people. This one article paraphrased that and said, it's as if David is saying, Lord, it's not just my emergency, my fear, my enemies, but these situations are the lot of all your people. Let your blessing, your saving help, also flow to them. Let me pray for us. Dear Lord, I thank you for these psalms. I thank you that you've given us an example of how to bring our fears to you. We do that today, Lord. There are things around us that are causing us fear. They will probably always be there. But you tell us to bring them to you, and that through you we can turn them into hope, and that we can trust in the ending that you've promised and you've accomplished for us. We pray that you would just continue to teach us what it means to not fear. In Jesus' name, amen.